Hi students, welcome to the discussions on the advanced shield designs. We are there in steel tanks, plated steel tanks. In the first part of this videos, we have seen how to design a plated water tank. We have fixed the size as well as we have fixed the stiffeners in the first part. In the second part, we have seen how to design the top tier girders or longitudinal girders as well as cross girders or main girders, right? In this third video, we shall see the design of staging, right? Design of staging, right? Now, that is how the staging or tower design means it consists of the design of one columns as well as the design of bracings, the design of bracings, right? That is how the design of staging, right? Now, let us see this is how the plan view of these longitudinal girders. Six longitudinal girders were there, which were supported on the three cross girders, are resting on six number of columns, because these three main beams requires two supports each at the end. That is how here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 number of columns are there. Which are supporting this entire tank, right? Therefore, this is what this part of the columns, along with the horizontal bracings and diagonal bracings, is what the staging part. Right? Then let's assume that this entire staging of 12 meter height is divided into three panels. Right? Then each of this height is now 4 meter, because 12 divided by 3 is equal to 4 meters, right? That is of the each of the staging height, right? Now let me show this view. One moment, friend. I'll show a schematic view of this, right? That is how this part we have already designed the tank, right, which was assumed as 1.2 meter each, right, and the chord length of radius of 0.3 meter, right? This part we have seen, this part, right? There's in one side view, another side view, the tank which was resting on the longitudinal beams, six longitudinal beams, which is which were resting on three cross beams, which are resting on six number of columns, right? Now that is how now we are there in this design of staging, right? Which consists of the design of the column as well as these diagonal bracings and the horizontal bracings. Right? That is this diagonal bracings as well as the horizontal bracing. Along with the joint at that intersection, right? And also the design of the base plate as well as the foundation, right? That is how the two views, front view as well as side view, the same. In plan view, right? Now let us examine the design, then this is how the staging is now divided into three equal parts, students, which is of 12 by 3 means 4 meter height each. Right? And the other day we already designed the main girder is of depth 800 mm. It was a built-up section. And also we have designed the cross gird, the longitudinal girders for IS. I think IS will be 325. Therefore, 325 is the depth, 0.325 meter. All these dimensions are now meters. Hence, the staging is now shown here, and the same is also shown in plan, right, at this level, right, which consists of six number of columns and three main girders also shown, and six number of longitudinal girders. Then now we'll do the analysis. Let us consider the wind pressure acting about a longitudinal direction. That is how I'll take longitudinal direction being more, right? For more the longitudinal direction, more the exposed area, hence you consider the longitudinal direction, right? Then however, the design wind pressure is already given. PD is equal to 1.05 kilonewton per meter square. And here I do have the ratio here B by D. Here the breadth to actually length to breadth, actually B by D here is the length to breadth, right? 7.5 is one dimension. In the other direction, it is 8.1 meters. Hence, this is now around 1.23. But in IS 875, we do have the either square shape towers or that of the rectangle or circular shapes, right? Therefore, rectangle means this B by D should be 2, but here it is 1. Therefore, 1.23 can be assumed approximately as 1. Hence, it falls under the category of square shape towers. This falls under the category of square shape towers, right? Then, and so from IS 875 part 3, even now I'll calculate what is that H by B. Height of this tank is 2.4 meter, whereas its breadth is equal to 7.5 meter. Now, if I calculate that ratio, it works out 0.32. This is less than 0.5. And so the load acting on that tank, PT, wind load acting on the tank, PT, right? This is now given by this, say PT is PD, design wind pressure multiplied by force coefficient CF multiplied by AE. Therefore, that gives now, say PD, already given in the problem that 1.05 kilometer per meter square and force coefficient from IS 875 for this square shape towers, and for H by B, if at all it is less than 0.5, therefore I'll note down from the table that the force coefficient is equal to 0.75. And what is that exposed area now? I'm taking the longitudinal direction. Hence, that tower is 7.5. Therefore, on either side, I do have 0.3 cantilever projection. Therefore, 0.6 if I add, the total length of this side is equal to 8.1 meter, and its height is equal to 2.4 meter. And also, in addition to that, even I do have the longitudinal girders like this, right, which are in the direction of the wind, Therefore, even wind will be obstructed by these longitudinal girders. And so the depth up to the bottom of that longitudinal girder is 2.4 plus 0.325. That is a 2.725 depth multiplied by 8.1 is the exposed area, obstructing the wind, right? Exposed area. Then multiplying this, now we get 16.27 kilonewtons acting at a height of YT from the bottom of the tank like this, from the bottom of the ground floor, or from ground floor level, it is acting at a height of YT. This PT, whose numeric value is equal to 16.22 YT. Then what is YT from this figure? Okay, I can say that this is equal to the height of the staging 12 meter plus this height of this main arc cross girder 0.8 meter, and plus 2.4 plus 0.325 as one unit divided by 2 at half of that. Therefore, adding all these, now I'll get 14.163 meters, right? This is a YT from the ground level, PT YT from natural ground level. And now we'll see that how much of force will be acting on the staging, PS, right? Therefore, generally, the staging consists of this horizontal bracing as well as diagonal bracing, just now shown in that schematic. And it is not totally solid as if that of this tank. This is having more openings, right? More openings are just only small part of it is obstructing the wind. Hence, now I'll assume that if that solidity ratio of this tower is assumed as 0.2, means 20% is only obstructing the wind. 80% is opening, right? Opening wind from windward side can enter into this tower and it can go to the leeward side. That is what the solidity ratio assumed as 20%. And for square towers from that IS 875 part 3, I do have the force coefficient CF 3.3. CF is equal to 3.3. Then once I get this force coefficient, then I'll find out the force on the staging, PS, is equal to force coefficient CF multiplied by PD, pressure intensity of the force, wind multiplied by exposed area. Now I do have CF is equal to 23.3 and pressure, wind pressure 1.05 kN per meter square multiplied by exposed area. Exposed area is nothing but now for this staging, staging is only 7.5 divided by 6.1 meters students. Please make a note. Previously the tank was 8.1 instead of 7.5 plus 0.6 means 8.1 by 6.7. Tank dimension was 6.7 by in this perpendicular dimension 8.1. However, here this is at 6.1 by 7.5. Therefore, for 8.1, I would have 7.5 multiplied by this height 12 plus 0.8. Even this will permit the passage of wind. Hence, 12.8 multiplied by 7.5. It is not solid. Only 20% of it is solid. Therefore, solid ratio 20%. Rest of the 80% is hollow. Right? Multiplying all these, now we'll get to say 66.53 kilonewton. Acting at a height of YS. YS is now 12 plus 0.8 divided by 2, or it is 6.4 meter. That is how PS acting at a height of YS. Now we'll consider some of the movements about this natural ground level, right? What is the overturning movement like this? Overturning movement about this vertical centroidal axis. Vertical centroidal axis or geometrical centroidal axis of this entire tower, right? Therefore, it now gives a clockwise couple of due to the force acting on the tank, PT multiplied by YT plus PS multiplied by YS. Substituting numeric values, now we'll get 16.22 multiplied by 14.163 plus 66.55 multiplied by 6.4, or it is 655.52 kilonewton meter. This is the overturning moment which will try to overturn the entire staging like this. However, resistance must be offered by the members in the opposite direction. Hence, what is that resistance or what is that additional axial thrust developed in each of these column in the form of resistance due to this wind force, additional axial thrust, PA. The other day, we have seen this derivation, students. I hope you remember that derivation, which is given by MW divided by N by 2 multiplied by R, whereas this overturning movement is equal to 655.52 kilonewton meter and N. There are six number of columns participating in resisting this overturning movement. Therefore, 6 by 2 means they form three couples, right? Resisting that overturning movement. And these two columns are there at every 6.1 meter. That is all, right? Each of these column is there at 6.1 meter. That is how they will form a resisting couple, right? For substituting with, now we'll get the additional axial thrust due to wind in each of these column is 35.22 kilonewton. If that is so, then let us examine what is its value compared to that of the total load on the column. Is it less than 1/3? Yes, let us check, right? Whereas we saw after analysis that we are having a maximum load on the column due to the reaction from the cross beam. This is the other day we have designed and we have analyzed the cross beams. It was throwing a reaction onto the column as 403. I'm just recalling that and substituting here 1/3 of 403.6 kilonewton is much more than this 35.22, much more than this 35.22, right? This 403.688 divided by 3 is around 134.56, but I do have only additional axial thrust as 35.27, which is less than 135.56. Therefore, okay, means that indicates that the column will only be designed for vertical loading, this 403.668 kilonewton. You need not consider this additional axial thrust due to wind. You need not consider, right? Therefore, that is how the comment or conclusion. If at all, this additional axial thrust, PA, what we got, let us say instead of 35, if I got, say, 135.22, but 135.22 is greater than 134.56. Then what we need to do is we must consider the wind into the in the design of the column. Therefore, then the wind will govern the design. Now, because PA is less than 1/3 of that load or reaction on that column or load in the column, or load in that column, therefore, that wind will not govern the design. Wind will not govern the design. Now, once I complete the analysis, I will move to the design of this column. Students, I hope you're understanding. Now, we'll do the design as per IAS 800-1984 students, right? Then, we already know what is that reaction onto that column, which is from the reaction from the main girder. This reaction from the main girder was 403.66 kilonewton, 403.66 kilonewton, right? That is what I've just recalled. And what is the sulfate of this column? A column, it is assumed at the rate of 0.44 kiloton per meter for an overall height of 12 meters. Therefore, 0.4 multiplied by 12 meter is equal to 4.8 kilonewton. If I add both of these, it is around the total load on the column is 408.46 kilonewton. However, now I'm assuming stiffness ratio of this column lambda is equal to 80. Actually, this assumption should be made keeping in view the experience. Here, experience matters, right? Therefore, this is not that huge load. 500 kiloton is around 400 kiloton is not huge load. Therefore, I can assume a moderate stiffness ratio lambda is equal to 80. And so, from IS 800-1984, from page number 39, from table 5.1, table 5.1, students, for yield strength of the steel, or yield stress of the steel, 250 grade steel. Now, I'll directly pick up what is a permissible axial compressive stress, sigma AC, notated by sigma AC. It is 101 MPa. Therefore, the area of the column required, A req, is equal to load divided by permissible stress in axial compression, P divided by sigma AC. Therefore, P is equal to 408.46 to the power 3 divided by 101. It is, and it now works out to 4044 mm square, right? Now, however, for designs, what we'll do is we'll generally increase this value by around 20, 25 to 50% students. Therefore, even if I increase this value by, let us say, 20%, I should try with, even if I'm increasing 20, I should search with a section area 4,853. Therefore, that is how let us choose from IS Indian Standard Structural Engineering's Handbook or steel tables. Either of the two is true, right? I'm choosing a column section, ISHB 200. 200 is the depth of that section at the rate of 0.37 kiloton per meter. Therefore, I'll note down the relevant properties or geometric properties area provided, A pro is equal to 4754. mm square, which is much greater than this area required. Actually, I'm trying with 20% excess, which gives an area around, I should search with 4,852, but I'm just fixing 4,754. Nevertheless, it may be satisfying the final strength criteria. And I'll note down the minimum radius of variation, R min, which is about YY axis, which is weak axis. And so that is 45.1 mm. And the length of each panel, because it is now divided into three panel students, therefore, obviously, in each of this panel, it just bends over 4 meter length only, not entire 12 meter length, right? And not over entire 12 meter length, right? That is, of now the length of each panel is equal to 4 meter, not 12 meter students. You need to remember this, right? And so the stiffness ratio over one panel length is equal to L by R min. R min is RYY. Therefore, length is equal to 4000 and divided by 46.1 mm, which is 88.7. Hence, from the same table, table number 5.1, page number 39, of IS 800. Now, I'll note down that for stiffness ratio 80, permissible axial compressive stress sigma AC is equal to 101 MPa. And also for 90, it is 90. Therefore, now I'll interpolate for 88.7, it is how much? How much is nothing but 101 minus 101 minus 90 divided by 90 minus 80 multiplied by 88.7 minus 80. That gives, upon interpolation, a value 91.43 MPa, Newton per mm square. Right? Once I get this sigma AC, hence, and I'll calculate what is the load carrying capacity of this column, which was proposed, is nothing but the stress permissible. Stress 91.43 multiplied by the area of this cross section, 4754. That divided by 10 to the power 3, divided by 10 to the power 3. Or it now works out, say 91.43 multiplied by 4754 divided by 1000. Or it works out, say 434.66 kilonewtons. 434.66 kilonewtons. But the load coming onto the column is only 403.66 kilonewtons, students. Therefore, the resistance is more than the action. Hence, the column section what you have proposed should be okay. Therefore, that is how the section itself is the final section what you have proposed. ISHB 200 at the rate of this 0.37 kilonewton per meter is my final section. Final section, right? Now, once I conclude that column design, now I'll move to the bracing designs, right? So far, you have seen this column design, students. Now I'll move to the analysis of this horizontal as well as the diagonal bracings, followed by their designs. I hope, students, you are understanding the analysis as well as designs, right? Then let us see the next part as analysis and design of bracings. First, we'll do the analysis. Once I get the design forces, then I'll go up to the design of these bracings also. Now taking this tower part, we already seen that the load on this staging was PS acting at the CG of this tower. Therefore, that load is now divided into three panels, students. Therefore, each of these panel will get PS by 3, PS by 3, PS by 3. And even that load is distributed half to each of these joint. Hence, PS by 6, PS by 6. From the first panel, similarly, PS by 6, PS by 6, PS by 6, PS by 6. In second and third panels also. Hence, at each of these node, I'll get PS by 6 plus PS by 6. Here, PS by 3. Here, PS by 6, PS by 3, PS by 3, PS by 6. Therefore, it's a total summation is equal to PS, right? PS loading on the staging right now. The maximum shear in extreme base here at the bottom base is the extreme base, the bottom panel, this horizontal bracing, student. Therefore, this is nothing but PS by 6 plus PS by 3 plus this PH by 6. Now I'll get it's a total summation is equal to given by 71.6 is divided by 3, because this, right, that works out 23.89, right? Then here the maximum shear in each extreme base is equal to, from this figure, right, PH by 6, because I'm getting a force of PH by 6. And also here, PH by 6, therefore that PH by 6 plus PH by 6 is equal to PH by 3. I'm sorry, right? Therefore, that PH by 6 plus PH by 6 is equal to PH by 3. But what is horizontal load? We have already fixed it in the previous calculation as 71.66 divided by 3, which is 23.89, right? Where that PH is nothing but the load on the top of this horizontal bracing, which is nothing but the summation of this total load from the tank PT plus this PS by 6 plus PS by 3 and plus this PH by 6. Only what is the loss is only PH by 6 from total PS load of the staging. What is only loss is PS by 6. Therefore, PS minus PS by 6 is equal to 5 PS by 6. Therefore, if I add that, now I'll get the total horizontal force at the top of the bottom panel level at this level is equal to PH. Once I get that PH, hence PH by 6, because that much of horizontal shear is taken care by three columns here, in total six columns are there. Therefore, each of these column is getting a shear force of PH by 6, each of this column, right? Therefore, now I'll take the bracing here. This bracing is already connected to the column, but this column is under a shear of PH by 6 here, even here PH by 6, right? Therefore, it's a total summation will try to give rise to a compression force in the horizontal bracing like this, a compression force of pH by 6 plus pH by 6 or pH by 3. It works out, upon substitution, it works out, say, 23.89, because 71.6 is by 3 is 23.89 kilonewton. And also from IS 800, we need to take additional transverse shear due to axial loading. Even this axial loading of 408.46 is there, that will add 2.5% in the form of transverse shear. Therefore, now recalling that 2.5 of the load on the column as well as the additional axial load due to wind, just now we have calculated that 35.82. Therefore, there is a total load including wind that will give rise to additional axial shear in this horizontal bracing that now works out 2.5. We had 100 multiplied by this total value is 11.11 kilonewton. And so the total compressive force is that previous 23.89 plus 11.11, or around 35 kilonewton compression is there in the horizontal bracing. Okay. Now, that is how, now once I conclude the analysis of this horizontal bracing, students, now I'll move to the design of horizontal bracing. Just now we got the load in the compression load in the horizontal bracing, which is notated by capital Q in derivations. Please refer back to that previous discussions or previous video. And its length between the two columns is equal to 6.1 meter. Hence, now I'll assume that this is connected by means of, say, one rivet or one bolt, students. I'll assume that it is connected more than one rivet. More than one rivet means some partial fixity is there. More than three means total fixity will be there, right? More than three means total fixity will be there. Just only one rivet means as if hinged like this, right? Two rivets are there means some partial fixity. Three means yes, almost rigid, right? That is all, right? Hence, partially fixed, then the effective length of this horizontal bracing, for finding out that effective length, I will use that IS 875. It says that if connected by two rivets, then the effective length may be taken for the column as 0.85L. 0.85 multiplied by length of this bracing is 6.1 meter. Therefore, 0.85 multiplied by 6.1 is equal to 5.185 meter. However, now here the force what we have in the horizontal bracing is 35 kilonewton, very small value. Hence, we may assume the stiffness ratio more stiffness ratio. Right, now let us see. Less force is there, more stiffness ratio. I am assuming compared to that of the previous case. Right, now from that same table 5.1 of page number 39 from IS 800 1984, I do have. For lambda 120, for Fy is equal to 250 MPa. The permissible axial compressive stress sigma AC, that basic value is equal to 64 MPa. Right? 64 MPa. However, if wind forces are also considered in the account, then I can increase the stresses by 33.33%. Therefore, if I increase by 33.33%, 64 multiplied by that increase is around 85.33 MPa. When wind forces are considered, this is the permissible stress. When wind is not considered, sigma AC is equal to 64 as appropriate. Now let us calculate the area required for this bracing. Now I'll do with this 35 kiloton is with wind. Therefore, 35 into 10 to the power 3 divided by 85.33. It now works out. Around 410 mm square, around 410 mm square. Then, however, here the 6.1 meter being a somewhat medium to large length. Now, what I'll assume is I'll increase this area by 25 to 50%. Even if I increase this by 50%, now I'll get some 615 mm square, but even then I'm trying with a higher section because that length is large, 6.1 meter. Because of that, the final effective slenderness ratio will be too large. Now let us try with a higher section because of this large length, 6.1 meter. So I'm trying with not around, say, 615 mm square students. I'm trying almost here and there, some three times more sectional area, right? And so I'm trying with ISA, Indian Standard Equal Angle Section, 110 by 110 by 8. That is ISA 110. This is 110 and this is also 110 and its thickness is equal to 8. That is the angle section I'm trying, right? Once I take that angle section with this thickness from steel tables, I'll note down the area provided, 17.2 mm square, but you are targeting only just around some 615 mm square, even considering 50% increase. Then I'll note down the minimum area R min, which is for such unsymmetric, this is unsymmetric section students, right? This will be having the minimum radius of gyration about the minor axis, right? Minor principal axis, RVV. Major principal axis is RUU. Major geometrical axis is RXX. Minor geometrical axis is RYY. Therefore, out of these RXX, RY, RV, RYY, RVV, RUU, now I do have RVV about this minor principal axis, which is 21.4, is R min. Therefore, the actual slenderness ratio is this 6.1 meter is is the actual length, which is assumed to be provided by means of more than one rivet. Therefore, the length, effective length is 5185. And so that effective length 5185 divided by this minimum radius of gyration, R min 21.4, it works out around 242.3. Now you can see that actually this is too large. However, this should not be more than 250, right? Therefore, okay. Now I'll take from the same table 5.1 for Fi is equal to 250. I do have the values for lambda is equal to 240, sigma c is equal to values available, and also lambda is equal to 250, sigma c values available. Therefore, now we'll interpolate for lambda is equal to 243. This is how much, right? For interpolation, I'll get permissible axial compressive stress, sigma ac, is 19.54 MPa. Okay. Once I get this 19.54 MPa, student, then how much of permissible compressive axial compression or how much load can be permitted in the bracing is nothing but the permissible axial compressive stress, sigma ac multiplied by area of that section, right? 19.54 multiplied by this 17.2 divided by 10 to the power 3, it gives around 44.33 kilonewton. Please make a note that here this basic value of this axial compressive stress is increased by 33.33% because this load 35 kilonewton is because of the wind. Hence the permissible axial compressive stress is not 19.54 multiplied by 1.33, 26.05. For 26.05 multiplied by 17.2 divided by 10 to the power 3 is 44.33 kilonewton, which is greater than 35 kilonewtons. Hence, okay. Means that assumed ISA 100 by 100 by 8 mm, this angle section is okay. Right? That's all. And once we do that, now I'll move to the next subheading as the riveted connections. Friends, I hope you're understanding this discussions. Right? Once I conclude the main structural components, now I'll move to the designs of the riveted connections. Right? Riveted connections. Then the assuming, this is my assumption, assuming nominal diameter of this bolt, nominal diameter of this bolt as, say, a value pi, rotated by pi, 16 mm, the gross diameter of that hole is equal to 1.5 extra. Therefore, 16 plus 1.5 is 17.5, notated by small d. Then, here, the angle is connected to one side of a gusset plate. Therefore, this connected by this also, right, like this. Therefore, this rivet is under only single shear. This is how it will shear off only at one weak plane. Therefore, the strength of this rivet, in single shear, like this. Right, like this. In single shear. Right? At this weak zone. Is pi by 4 multiplied by d square, 17.5 whole square multiplied by permissible shear stress in rivet 100 MPa from table 19 of IS 800, 1984. However, here the section is also governed by the wind. Therefore, the stresses in the connections can be increased by 25%. For the connections, the stresses must be increased by 25%, students. Whereas for the section designs, the stresses should be increased by 33.33%. That will be 10 to power 3. Now it gives around 30.07 kilonewton is what the strength of the rivet in single shear, right? Single shear, PS. Right? Now I'll take the strength of the rivet in bearing. Now I have to have an angle of 8 mm thickness connected to a gusset plate. Generally, that gusset plate will be having a thickness more than that of this thickness of this angle. This thickness of the angle is only 8 mm. So generally, the thickness of the gusset is assumed at least greater than 8. Therefore, or say 10 mm. Therefore, the thickness that governs for the bearing is 8 mm or 10 mm out of these two. 8 mm. Main section will fail first rather than that of the gusset plate. Generally, the gusset plates are not supposed to fail. They must be designed safely to transport all the loads to the joints. Right? Hence, the bearing area is nothing but the area of that diameter of that hole multiplied by the thickness, 8 mm. For that main angle, 17.5 multiplied by 8, multiplied by permissible bearing stress, 300 MPa, increased by 25% for wind, divided by 10 to power 3, it works out 52.5 MPa, kilonewtons, right? Hence, the rivet value, this is PB, this is PS. Rivet value is nothing but, is defined as the strength of a rivet, a rivet can resist. This is nothing but the strength which can be resisted by one rivet. Therefore, that is least of these strength of the rivet in shear as well as in bearing. Out of these two, 30.07 will govern. Hence, R rivet value R is equal to 30.07 kilonewton. Once you calculate that, then how many number of rivets are required is nothing but the total load in this diagonal bracing, 35 kilonewton divided by rivet value, 30.07. Now if I divide, now I'll get 1.64, but let us say to the next integer as say two rivets. That is how we already assumed that in the initial assumption itself, it was assumed that we will provide at least two number of rivets like this, right? That is how to one gusset plate, this horizontal bracing is provided by two number of rivets in one horizontal row, not in vertical fashion. If I provide in vertical fashion, then the area of the connected leg will reduce. Therefore, we'll provide in one row, two rivets, if need be three rivets like this, but in one row, so that at a given net section, only one deduction will be done for one connected leg, and so two rivets. So that is in line with our assumption. Once I conclude that design of horizontal bracing, students, now I'll move to design of diagonal bracing. Therefore, that is how we already seen this design Q, horizontal shear, or the compressive force, horizontal shear in at that level itself is compressive force in that horizontal bracing. Because of that, this entire diagonal bracing will try to extend because this horizontal member is compressing, hence only at the cost of increasing the length of this diagonal bracing. Hence, let FT be the tension in the diagonal bracing, whose length is equal to capital L, and let it is inclined at an angle of theta with the horizontal. Right? Then I'll take one panel, students. That is the view of one panel, and here, this is how that compression means forces moving away from the joint are notated by compression. Forces which are into the joint are tension, means this member is a tensile force. Near the joint, it is into the joint, tension. Here, near the joint, it is away from the joint, compression. Right? That is of the notation part. Then we know the height of this panel, L is equal to 4 meter, and this base width B is equal to 6.1 meter, or A is equal to 6.1 meter, and this height is equal to 4 meter. Therefore, the length of this diagonal bracing is square root of 6.1 plus 4 meters. It works out 7.29 meters. Hence, the forces are directly proportional to the length, means Q by A, because Q is over a length of A, 6.1 meter. FT is over a length of L. Therefore, FT by L is equal to Q by A, or FT is equal to the tension in the diagonal bracing is QL by A. But we already know what is Q to 35, and its length of the diagonal bracing as 7.29 divided by A, 6.1 meter. It gives 41.85 kilonewton. And also from the same figure, we can find out what is cos theta. Cos theta is nothing but this 6.1 divided by this diagonal length, A by L, right? And also alternatively, we can say that, but A by L is nothing but Q by FT also. Both are same, right? Then, please see that here this diagonal length 7.29 is too large, right? For tension, right? Even the Stannage ratio should not be more than 350 for tensile members, right? Then, I'll divide this into two parts. I already shown in the previous schematic that the diagonals are connected at the center of these by one rivet like this, right? One rivet, so that this tense, this length will be divided into two equal lengths, right? That is all, right? Therefore, now I'll, by assuming that at least one rivet of 60 mm is provided at the intersection of these two diagonal bracings, then the effective length is equal to L by 2, 7.29 by 2, or say 3.645 meters. Right? Then from IS 800, the permissible stress, axial stress in the axial tension, sigma AT, the basic value is equal to 0.6 multiplied by Fy, 250 is 150 MPa. Then that is without wind, whereas if I take into effect the wind, 33.33% extra for section designs. Therefore, 150 multiplied by 1/3 increase means additional 50, 200 MPa sigma AT with wind, 200 without wind, 150. And so the net area required taking into account wind, because on the diagonal bracings as well as horizontal bracings, wind load is compulsorily the wind load will be acting, right? Then total tension divided by permissible axial tensile stress. Now 41.85 into 3 divided by 200, which works out 200 mm square. However, this increase area by at least 25 to 50% in tension, right? Even if I assume 25%, it is around 260 mm square. Even if I assume 50% more, it is around some 315 mm square, right? Now, hence, let us try with ISA equal angle section 60 by 60 by 6 mm angle, 60 by 60 by 6 mm angle section, right? That is our 60, 60. Its thickness is equal to 6 mm. Having now, if that is true, then I'll note down what are the areas and other parameters. That area, I'll note down that area. Just a moment, right? However, the minimum radius of variation is about minor principal axis RVV. Once again, as we have discussed in the previous case, but this being say symmetric section, RUU itself is RVV, and RXX itself is RYY. Please make a note. Fine. And for that is 11.55 mm. However, the stiffness ratio for this tension member should not be more than 350. Now let us calculate what is the actual stiffness ratio over this 3.645 meters length, not entire 7.29 meters, because we already provided one rivet, therefore only over half of that 3.645 or 3645 mm divided by 11.5 mm, it works out around 317, but that is less than 350 stiffness ratio. Therefore okay, right? Then if not, you can increase the section. Student, let us say if this is exceeding by a value of 350, then there is no other option. But what you can do, you can increase this section from ISA 60 by 60 by 6 to maybe some ISA 75 by 75 by some 8 mm, or ISA 90 by 90 by some 8 mm or 10 mm as appropriate. So that this RVV value will increase. Once there is an increase in the denominator, this value will decrease. That is how a next higher section may be assumed if it is failing in that criteria. Right? Then once I get that, then the angle is connected to one side of a gusset plate, students, right? One side of a gusset plate, right? Like this. Therefore, what's the area of this connected leg? Area of this connected leg is nothing but this. 60 is the area of this connected leg is length of this connected leg 60 minus half the thickness here, minus 6 by 2, because this 6 is common for both connected leg as well as outstanding leg, right? And a rivet hole of 17.5, assuming 16 mm, the rivet hole is 17.5. therefore, if I deduct that, now I'll get the effective width multiplied by its thickness is equal to 6 mm. For the area of this connected leg is equal to 237, then area of this outstanding leg is 60 minus 6 by 2 multiplied by its thickness 6 mm or say 342 mm square. Then from IS 800, one angle connected to one side of the gusset plate, then the formula is equal to K. For finding out the effective net effective area, 3A1 divided by 3A1 plus A2. If I substitute, what is A1, what is A2? We already know from the calculation. Then by substituting with, now I'll get this value as say 0.675. Therefore, the net area provided, A net prov, is equal to area of this connected leg 237 plus 67.5% of this area of this outstanding leg 342. It works out 468 mm square, but you are targeting only just a value of around some 209 mm square. Even if I increase by 25%, you are just targeting around say some 215 and 262 mm square. Therefore, this is much greater than that requirement of 269. Therefore, the tensile load carrying capacity of the section, how much of tension it can carry, is the permissible axial tensile stress, including the wind, 200 MPa, then multiplied by an effective area provided by this angle is 468 mm square divided by 10 to the power 3. It gives 93.6 kilonewton as against a tensile force action of 48.75. It is resisting. Resistance is equal to 93.6 kilonewton. This is much more, or otherwise even you can up, further optimize the section by using a lower section. Maybe I say 50 by 50 by 6 mm also, you can try if you wish, right? There is a further optimization may be done, right? Now, once I do that, I'll proceed with this ISA 60 by 60 by 6 because that is a nominal section. Even 6 mm itself is nominal thickness, right? I don't want to further reduce the section. Then I'll try to provide a repeated connection of this angle with that of the gusset plate. That of the gusset plate, as I discussed in the previous subheading. As in the previous subheading, we have seen that rivet value worked out 30.02. But the number of rivets required is nothing but the force, tensile force in the member is 41.85 divided by this rivet value RV 30.02. It works out 1.39, but fix it to the next integer, say two numbers. Therefore, two numbers of 60 mm diameter are provided to this ISA 65 by 65, sorry, ISA 60 by 60 by 6 mm as the final section, as the final section for this diagonal bracing, right? Once we do this design of the diagonal bracing, student, then I'll move to the next subheading as design of the base plate. Students, I hope you're understanding the analysis as well as designs, right? Now we are into the design of base plate, right? This entire column is resting on the pedestal. In between the pedestal and the column, there is a base plate. Therefore, I need to design this base plate, right? How? That is the maximum load, including the wind thrust. This without wind, due to dead load and live load, 408.46 kilonewton, which is as obtained as reaction from the main girder, plus additional axial thrust due to wind, 35.82. We have seen in previous subheading the numeric value, right? Summation of these two is equal to 444.28 kilonewton. Then, assuming M15 grade concrete is already given in the problem, that use M15 grade concrete, or you may be using M20 grade concrete. Fine, this is material, right? Then from table 21 and page 81 of IS 456-2000. Code book. Actually, then I do have the permissible direct stress, direct compressive stress in the concrete pedestal is equal to 4, sigma cc is equal to 4. Right? However, there is a basic value. This is already inclusive of wind. Therefore, increase these stresses by 33.33%. It now works out sigma cc is equal to 4 multiple 1.33, say 5.33 MPa. Now let us calculate how much of area of this base plate required. One without wind, 408.46 10 to the power 3 divided by basic value of 4 MPa. It gives, say, 102.115 mm square, right? Whereas even if I consider the wind into effect, then the force is nothing but 444.28 divided by the stress due to wind, 5.33, it is around 76,634 mm square compared to that of the previous value of 1 lakh odd. Therefore, out of these two, whichever is maximum will govern the design. From this, what I can say is that wind is not governing the design of the base plate, because there you are getting less area required for the base plate, around 76,600 value compared to that of without wind, I require 1,02,000 mm square roughly, right? Therefore, wind will not govern the design of this base plate. Generally, we will under apprehension that wind will, all once wind has governed the design of the column or that of the horizontal bracing or diagonal bracing, it will also govern the base plate also. No. For each and every component, we need to check whether that governs or not, right? If it governs, then only we need to design for that, otherwise not. Hence, I'm not designing for wind now. Without wind itself is, I'm designing now. Also, the column section was assumed as ISHB 200, its depth was 200 mm, which is resting on this base plate like this, right? Therefore, and from steel tables, if I see what is the depth of this section, this ISHB 200 means depth of this section, and also the width of this flange is also 200 mm. Therefore, B is also 200 mm. Hence, now I'll say that using these, almost a square base plate may be provided, maybe, right? Or even may provide a rectangular base plate also. That is left to you. But now I'll assume that a square base plate will be assumed. Then if I assume so, then what now I'll do is I'll check now how much of size is required. The size being a square, therefore square root of this 1,02,115 mm square, it is around 318 odd, or say around 320, right? Let us provide a base plate of 350 mm by 350 mm, a square size 350 mm by 350 mm, like this 350 mm by 350 mm size, right? Then however, now the projections, the larger projection as well as the smaller projection, right, from this 350 now, from 350 this 200 has gone, therefore this projection which is acting as if a cantilever, right, as A is equal to B, smaller projection is equal to larger projection, because this is a square, both are 75 mm 75 mm respectively. And I'll calculate the actual intensity of the pressure on that concrete pedestal. It is equal to small, notated by small w, intensity of this pressure intensity, the actual load without wind 408.46 kilonewton divided by actual area of the base plate provided 350 square. That ratio gives 3.34 MPa, which is less than the permissible direct compressive stress in the concrete pedestal as 4 MPa. Hence okay. Now I'll go to page number 44 of IS 800-1984. Then what is the thickness required for this base plate because of this bending of this cantilever part? It now gives a formula. T required is equal to square root of 3W divided by sigma Bs multiplied by A square minus B square by 4, where Bs is the permissible bearing stress given by of the steel base plate section, which is given by 0.85 multiplied by Fi. Fi is equal to 250. It now works out 185 MPa. Substituting all these numerics, 3 multiplied by 3.34 divided by 185 multiplied by square root of, multiplied by 75 square minus 75 by 75 square divided by 4, whole under root. It works out around 15.1 mm. However, the actual thickness available in the market is, either you check whether 60 mm is available or 18 mm is available. That is, upon checking, you please provide this actual thickness. Let us say 60 mm is available, hence provide 60 mm. If 17 mm is available, 17 mm, right? Generally, after 16, 18 is thickness available, and 20 thickness is available. You check with the availability in the market. Right, hence provide ISA, this base plate of 350 by 350 with a thickness of 16 mm as the base plate, and also provide ISA 75 by 75 by 6 mm nominal section angle connecting the flange of this column with that of the base plate, like this, students. That of the base plate, right? That is all. This is the flange, right? Which is resting, right? Like this, right? This is of the flange. And now we assume ISA 75 by 75 by 6, so that it will provide a connection with the web to that of the base plate, and also it will take care of the bending moments, if any, right, due to partial fixity, right, by means of 220 mm rivets, two, right, that is here and here, not in one row, two, right, along the length of that angle, right. Then once we get this as once we get this Now we'll move to design of anchor bolts, right? I hope you understood how we designed the base plate students, right? Once we do that, now I'll move to the design of anchor bolts, right? Now we already got the force, horizontal force on the bottom of the panel as 71.66, which is nothing but the load on the tank plus 5/6 of the load on the staging also, right? Therefore, that worked out to be 71.66 kilonewton. Answer, that much of force will be there, which is at the bottom, at the top of the panel, will also be trying to shear at the base plate. These anchor bolts, right? They will try to shear these anchor bolts. Answer, in order to resist that much of shear force, we'll be providing the anchor bolts like this, right there. However, from code book, I do have the allowable shear stress, tau V, for the anchor bolts as 80. However, wind is already considered in the design, hence increase for the bolts or rivets or for welded connections by 25%. Now I'll get permissible shear stress as 100 MPa. Hence, the area of the bolt shank required, AS required, is equal to total force in the bolts, shear force, divided by permissible shear stress, right? Therefore, 71.66 divided by 10^3 divided by 100. However, at least at the four corners of the base plate, I should assume four anchor bolts like this, four anchor bolts, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, so that uniform distribution of this stress intensity will happen onto the base plate. Therefore, now assuming four bolts at least, now I require area of the each bolt shank as 179.15 mm square. Assuming 60 mm dia shank of the bolt, area provided is equal to 5/4 16, say 201 mm square, but you require only 179 mm square. Therefore, 201 is much greater than 179, hence okay. Now let us check how much of, right? This is okay from the shear point of view, students, right? This is okay from the shear point of view, like this. Therefore, these four bolts will not succeed in shearing this section, but is it okay from uplift point of view, right? That is how, whether is it okay if wind load is acting, then due to overturning moment, will it be uplifted? Whether these four anchor bolts, are they okay in resisting the uplift also like this, right? That check will now I'll make, right? Therefore, let us calculate the uplift in each of these column due to wind that you already seen, the additional axial load due to wind as 35.82 kilonewton. Then wind blowing when tank is empty. You please see that when tank is empty, when wind is blowing, obviously it has a more tendency to overturn rather than that of when it is full. If it is full means it will not try to overturn. When it is empty, then it can be easily washed away, or at least it can easily bend like this, as if a cantilever, right? Therefore, when tank is empty, if wind is blowing, then entire tank along with the staging will try to overturn. There's a critical condition. And so now I'll calculate what is that weight of that water which can be stored in the tank. It's a gross dimensions is equal to 8.1 multiplied by 6.7 multiplied by height 2.4 meter, assuming choking up of the tank outlet at the top, that multiplied by 9.81, that divided by 10^3, it works out around 1277.73 kilonewton is the weight of that tank, right? Then however, if that is the weight of the tank, then I need to distribute this to the six number of columns, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, four exterior columns taking a load of WWWW, right? In plan we have seen already, right? And two interior columns taking a load of two times that of the exterior columns. Therefore, in total, I do have four W's plus two multiplied by two W1's. But W1 is equal to two times W. Therefore, 4W plus 4W, 8W. Therefore, 1277.73 is equal to 8W. Therefore, load on each column is equal to how much? Is equal to 1277.73 divided by 8. That is all. Now I'll get the load on each column as 159.72 students. This value, what I'm getting is 159.72. I got right. But however, we already analyzed the cross beam, and we got a reaction from the cross beam as 406 point odd value, and also we have added self weight, right? There it worked out to be 408.46. Therefore, that is inclusive of water plus self weight plus dead load plus water weight, right? Therefore, from that, if I deduct what is the pure weight of that water on each column, that weight of that water is equal to 1277 divided by 8, which is 159.72. Now I'll get the empty weight of this tank. Empty weight, purely empty, right? No water is there in this tank, right? Just empty, which can easily be overturned like this, right? Therefore, that is 408.46 minus 159.72 is equal to 248.76. But what is that? This is that resistance of total overturning. Overturning force or uplift in the column. However, the load on the column when a tank is empty, still that much of compression force, downward force, 248.76 kilonewton still acting due to gravity. However, due to wind, we are trying to uplift this by 35.82 kilonewton. Therefore, this 35.82 cannot succeed in uplifting this 248.76 empty weight of this tank acting in the downward direction. Therefore, the downward direction force 248.76 when it is empty is much greater than the upward uplift force due to wind of 35.82. Hence, this uplift will not happen. And that is how the design of the anchor bolt, right? Similarly, now you can design the foundation also, or pedestal. I think that we already done in RCC. I'll skip off that design. Students, with this now I'll conclude, right? We'll meet in the next class with next series of these discussions on advanced shield design with the design of pressed steel tanks, right? Thank you, students, for watching this video. If you like this video, you try to click like, share to our YouTube channel, right? Thank you. We'll meet in the next session. Till then, bye-bye, students.